From Norway came an urgent call for financial assistance in rebuilding her merchant marine. Italy asked for money and machinery to restore her industries and to increase her power plants. Turkey needed funds for industrial projects which would enable her to help other Marshall Plan countries. And Ireland required fodder for livestock, which she planned to market abroad. Thus, each country stated its needs. Meanwhile, at Washington, the United States Congress, the elected representatives of the American people, appropriated $5 billion for aid to Europe in the first year of the Marshall Plan. To supervise this four-year program, the American government appointed Paul G. Hoffman, one of the ablest administrators in the United States. And as the news spread across the nations of Western Europe, the people took note of the heartwarming fact that most Marshall Plan funds were not a loan, but an outright gift from the people of America.
In the House of Commons, Mr. Ernest Bevin said today, "I think it is time to pay a tribute to the great heart of the American people which found expression in the European Recovery Program."
C'est sans doute la première fois qu'un peuple accepte d'aussi grands sacrifices pour venir en aide à d'autres peuples. Le porte-parole a précisé ensuite...
Within a short time, tons of grain arrived to ease the shortage of food and the suffering of millions who were hungry. There were dockside celebrations when the first shipments were unloaded, and hope rose in the hearts of the people who sensed the dramatic beginning of a new chapter in Europe's long history. But the aims of the Marshall Plan are long-range as well as immediate. It seeks to provide Europe not only with food, but with the means to produce it. Europeans themselves would have to provide the planning, the initiative, the skill, and the work. Soon, in Holland, mills that had been closed called back their experienced workers. For suddenly there was enough raw cotton, thousands of bales of it from the United States, and when there is cotton in Holland, there is work for all hands in the mills. Jan Buva, the weaver, went back to work to use his skill to make the cloth that could be sold in other countries and thus provide an income for Holland. Meanwhile, in England, a gigantic new coal hoist, built in America and bought with Marshall Plan funds, was delivered to the mine in which John Clayton worked. With this hoist installed, the miners would be able to get out of the ground more of the vitally needed coal than they ever could before. In the first year of the Marshall Plan alone, Britain's coal output rose by almost 13 million tons. And after years in which there was scarcely enough to meet the demands of home consumption, shipments of coal to neighboring countries began once more. With fuel again available, with raw materials again moving across the borders of Western Europe, factories came back to life. At the Fiat plant in Italy, new automobiles were coming off the assembly lines, and for mechanics like Pietro Leone, the specter of unemployment had vanished. Whatever Europe needed for recovery could now be obtained with Marshall Plan funds. From America to Marseille came shipments of sulfur to be converted into sulfate and used to protect the great vineyards of France. Norwegian fishing smacks were plying up and down the coast once more. Equipped with new nets, they were operating with their old efficiency, taking huge drafts of herring and sardines. With funds allotted by the Marshall Plan, the Norwegian canning industry was also thriving. to pack and markets in foreign lands with money to pay for them. More and more shipments of sardines were turning up in the shops of England, and British housewives like Mrs. John Clayton were among the customers who bought them. With the money earned by selling abroad the cars that Pietro Leone made, Italy could now purchase flour. And because there was flour, Pietro could buy spaghetti again. Now that the French economy was reviving, Marcel Robier regained his confidence in money and agreed to sell the products of his farm. One thing Farmer Robier wanted badly was a tractor. And through the Marshall Plan, tractors were finally available. But Robier found it hard to understand why he should pay for a tractor that came as a gift from America. Actually, the tractor was given by all the people of America, who paid for it with taxes, to all the people of France. The francs Marcel Robier paid for it went into a special French fund. And the money in this counterpart fund would be used to pay for more recovery, for projects of permanent benefit to all the people of France. With his new tractor, Robier found he could work his fields many times faster than ever before, and so increased the yield of his farm. The money which he and other farmers paid for the agricultural machinery they bought under the Marshall Plan helped to meet the cost of great new power plants being built in France. These power plants not only provided jobs for thousands of workers, but would soon make life better for French families throughout the countryside. Such signs of recovery were everywhere. In Greece, old roads were repaired and modern highways built with counterpart funds created by Marshall Plan imports. In many countries, these funds were spent to provide new housing for families left homeless by the war. And so it went throughout free Europe during the first years of the Marshall Plan. In nation after nation, the results of economic cooperation were beginning to show. There were more jobs in the factories and more goods produced by men who were skilled and who needed only raw materials to turn their skill to good account. As production rose, all over Europe, shop windows were filled again. Europeans, working together well and hard, were setting new production records. Even in the first year of the Marshall Plan, free Europe produced 10% more food than in the previous year. Coal production rose 11%. Textile yarns increased almost 18%. And steel production rose 40%. The progress made exceeded expectations, but there was still a long way to go before 1952 ended martial aid. Pietro Leone was optimistic. He had his job again and could breathe more easily, though many of his friends were still unemployed. John Clayton and his family were well and thriving. Their diet was adequate, but they still could not afford many of the things they wanted. Marcel Robier was better off than many of his countrymen, but the future of France looked promising, and French men and women could face that future with the knowledge that they were a free people in a community of free nations. It was a knowledge shared by Jan Bouva and the other members of his textile workers' union. For For at the turn of the half century, millions of people throughout Western Europe knew that the Marshall Plan worked, and they were working with it in these first years of recovery, in these years of decision.